Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you'd care to. We're going to pick it up today. 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 6, the last chapter of 1 Kings. So in our last lecture, we left off with Ahab having defeated, with God's help, of course, the armies of Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, not once, but twice. And God instructed Ahab, destroy Ben-Hadad. Well, what did Ahab do? Well, he made an alliance with him that they would be, he even called Ben-Hadad his brother as he being a king, a fellow king. Well, 3 years after the second defeat of the Syrians had rolled by, and Ahab decided it's time to take the war to the Syrians. Well, he calls on the king of Judah, a righteous king, Jehoshaphat, who they had joined together in an affinity, as it's called in 1 Chronicles. And what that means is that it's 2 Chronicles, excuse me. But what happened was Ahab and Jezebel's daughter, Athaliah, married Jehoshaphat's son. Jehoram was his name. And that alliance that they made turned into a military alliance. And in our last lecture, we ended with Ahab inviting Jehoshaphat to join in the fight against the Syrians at Ramoth-Gilead. And the last thing that we covered, Jehoshaphat said unto the king of Israel, inquire, I pray thee, at the word of the Lord today. Jehoshaphat should have thought about inquiring of the Lord before he left Judah to join Ahab. But with that, we're going to ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day. 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 6, and it reads, then the king of Israel, that's Ahab, gathered the prophets together, about 400 men, and said unto them, shall I go against Ramoth-Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear, should I not go? And they said, go up, for the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. And the Lord didn't say this. This is 400 of Ahab and Jezebel's prophets. It seemed like they always had 450 prophets of this or 400 prophets of that hanging around. But you see, these people are all speaking their own heart, their own mind, and not the word of God. Verse 7, and Jehoshaphat said, is there not here a prophet of the Lord, that's Yahweh, besides, that we might inquire of him? He knows that these 400 are prophesying out of their own heart and their own mind. He knows that they're false prophets. Isn't there just one prophet of the Lord? And you know, 400 prophets all trying to put deceit on the people. You know, 400, the number is insignificant. If they're all speaking their own mind, one prophet who is actually speaking the word of God is far more valuable than 400 speaking their own heart and their own mind, is the point. Verse 8, and the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, there is yet one man, Micaiah, the son of Imlah, by whom we may inquire of the Lord. But I hate him, for he doth not prophesy good concerning me, but evil. And Jehoshaphat said, Let not the king say so. Don't say that. You see, Ahab, being a wet noodle that he was heavily influenced by his wife, Jezebel. And you remember, she's not even of Israel. She's from Zidon, and her father was a Baal priest. So, you see, Ahab thought that the prophets had the power to influence the deity that they represented. So he thinks that Micaiah just doesn't like him, and that's the reason that he always prophesies evil. It's not that Micaiah doesn't care much for Ahab, knowing what a crud he and Jezebel were, but he's prophesying correctly evil, and it is the word of the Lord. Verse 9. Then the king of Israel called an officer and said, "Hasten hither Micaiah, the son of Imlah." Ahab isn't going to like Micaiah's forthcoming prophecy any more than he's liked his prophecies in the past. Verse 10. And the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, sat each on his throne, having put on their robes, looking very royal, very kingly. In the void, this in the Hebrew, the word void is floor, probably a threshing floor, place in the entrance of the gate of Samaria. And all the prophets prophesied before them. This is the 400 false prophets. And, you know, what a revival that must have looked like. You know, when Antichrist appears here on earth, so many people have turned away from God and apostatized and refused Jesus Christ as their Savior. I tell you this, when the Antichrist appears here on earth and he's able to snap his fingers and lightning will come down from heaven, there's going to be quite a revival at that time too. I couldn't help but think about that when I read this verse. But these 400 are putting on a show, and that's all it is show. Verse 11. And Zedekiah, the son of Kenina, made him horns of iron. Now, what he's doing here is picking up on Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 17, when Moses used the horns was transferring the blessing that was upon Joseph on to Ephraim. Zedekiah here, the false prophet, is missing the condition that was established in Deuteronomy 33, and that was fidelity to the Lord. He doesn't have a loyal bone in his body as far as the Lord is concerned. And he said, this is Zedekiah the false prophet, "Thus saith the Lord, with these shalt thou push the Syrians until thou hast consumed them," and prophesying out of his own heart, out of his own mind. And it's very dangerous. If you want to know what God thinks about false prophets, you make a side note and a side study of Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 12. "And all the prophets prophesied so," this is the 400, "saying, Go up to Ramoth Gilead and prosper, for the Lord shall deliver it into the king's hand. You be victorious." Watch out for those who prophesy out of their own heart. You know, these 400, after Syria has killed Ahab dies in battle with the Syrians. After that happens, and Jezebel finds out that they told Ahab to go up to Ramoth Gilead, "You'll be successful, you'll prosper," they're all going to be looking for a place to hide because Jezebel is after them. Verse 13. "And the messenger that was gone to call Micaiah spake unto him, saying," and this is as they are returning from him picking up Micaiah, "Behold now the words of the prophets," the 400, "declare good unto the king with one mouth." They're all saying the same thing. Go up and prosper at Ramoth-Gilead. Let thy word, I pray thee, be like the word of one of them, and speak that which is good. Tell Ahab that he's going to prosper and please the king. Maybe he'll give us all an extra ration tonight, maybe an extra cup of wine tonight, if you please the king. Verse 14, and Micaiah said, as the Lord liveth, this is an oath, a serious oath, what the Lord saith unto me, that will I speak. And that's what a prophet should speak. A prophet should not be worried about what men think about what he's going to say. It's only important that he says what the Lord gives him to speak. False prophet, worry about pleasing men. Verse 15. So he came to the king, and the king, this is Ahab, said unto Micaiah, shall we go against Ramoth-Gilead to battle, or shall we forbear? And he answered him, go and prosper, for the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. And he says this so sarcastically and so mockingly that Ahab knows that he's not telling him the truth. And let me ask you, did Ahab ask, what is the word of the Lord concerning whether we should go up? No, he said, Micaiah. So Micaiah was throwing his 2 cents worth in. And the king, this is Ahab, said unto him, how many times shall I adjure thee, this word adjure means to charge or command thee, that thou tell me nothing but that which is true in the name of the Lord? He didn't ask what the word of the Lord was. He asked Micaiah what he thought. He knew Micaiah was being sarcastic. Now, whether he wants it or not, Ahab is going to get the word of the Lord. And he, this is Micaiah, the prophet, said, I saw all Israel scattered upon the hills as sheep that had no shepherd. And the Lord said, these have no master. Let them return every man to his house in peace. And what this verse is saying is that Israel is going to go to war, and the shepherd, or the master, which is the king, is going to be killed. And then the others, after they are scattered upon the hills, will go home every man to his house in peace. This prophecy to Ahab, Ahab, you are going to die. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, did I not tell thee that he would prophesy no good concerning me, but evil? That prophet Micaiah just does not like me at all. If he did, he would try and change Yahweh's mind. Verse 19. And he said, hear thou therefore the word of the Lord. And this is Micaiah continuing. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and all the host of heaven standing by him on his right hand and on his left. Ahab, or I should say the Lord, about to point out Ahab's prophets are lying. So here we have the sons of God, the angels, and the Lord gathered all together. Verse 20, and the Lord said, who shall persuade, this word probably better translated, deceive Ahab, that he may go up and fall or die at Ramoth-Gilead? And one said on this manner, and another said on that manner. They're deciding how to get rid of Ahab. I'll tell you one thing, think about that. I sure hope I never do anything so evil that the Lord and all the angels in heaven are gathered together trying to figure out my demise. That's what they're doing, is figuring out Ahab's demise. He deserves it. 21. And there came forth a spirit and stood before the Lord, and said, I will persuade him, or I'll deceive him. What does this spirit have in mind? He could think of this spirit as an angel. And the Lord said unto him, wherewith? In other words, what's your game plan? How are you going to deceive Ahab? And he said, I will go forth, and I will be a lying spirit in the mouth of all his prophets. It had already happened. And he said, thou shalt persuade him and prevail also. Go forth and do so. God allowed this. And, you know, some people might say, well, poor Ahab. No, this is bad that what the Lord is allowing evil to accomplish good. And poor Ahab. Well, you need to go back and read the last several chapters concerning Ahab, what he and Jezebel did to Naboth to take away his vineyard. They murdered Naboth and his sons. That was nothing to them, but Ahab is about to meet his Waterloo. Verse 23. Now therefore, behold, the Lord hath put a lying spirit, this is Micaiah speaking to Ahab and his, and Jehoshaphat, in the mouth of all these thy prophets, the 400, and the Lord hath spoken evil concerning thee, misfortune or calamity concerning Ahab. Ahab, you are going to die. But Zedekiah, this is kind of the leader of the 400 false prophets, the son of Kenana, went near and smote Micaiah on the cheek. He was enraged and said, which way went the Spirit of the Lord from me to speak unto thee? I couldn't help but think about when they were preparing Christ to crucify him in Mark chapter 14. Verse 65, where they were mocking him and spat upon him, even blindfolded him, and then they would go up and smite him and say, and prophesy, who struck you? They're going to get theirs, and that's written in chapter 1 of the book of Revelation. But they're asking Micaiah, they're questioning whether he is really a prophet or not. And Micaiah said, behold, thou shalt see in that day. You'll see in that day that the Spirit of God is not with you, is what he's saying, when thou shalt go into an inner chamber to hide thyself. And this would happen at the end of the war when Jezebel found out that these 400 had falsely prophesied and told Ahab to go up to Ramoth-Gilead and he would prosper. They were all looking for a place to hide in a chamber within a chamber. Verse 26, and the king of Israel, Ahab, said, take Micaiah and carry him back unto Amon, the governor of the city, and to Joash, the king's son. And we learn in 2 Chronicles chapter 18, 26, that he was in prison and they took him back to prison. That's where the officer went and fetched Micaiah from, where he had been before. Not one of Ahab's favorite people. Verse 27, and say, thus saith the king, put this fellow in the prison and feed him with bread of affliction and with water of affliction until I come in peace. It would be a long wait for them to wait for Ahab to return in peace. It's not going to happen. God has prophesied that Ahab would die, that the shepherd, the master of verse 17, that the people would wander around because they had no shepherd or master. Ahab was going to die. This bread of affliction and water of affliction refers to distress, if you will. The scant quantity of the water and the food, and also the quality of the food. 28. If you ever wanted to be a prophet of the Lord, I've heard a lot of people say, oh yes, I'd like to be a prophet. It wasn't for any sissies, I'll guarantee you, in many cases. Verse 28, and Micaiah said, if thou return at all in peace, the Lord hath not spoken by me. And he said, hearken, O people, every one of you. And remember, with Jehoshaphat and Judah there, Ahab and Israel, Micaiah is calling the leaders, the representatives of both Israel and Judah to witness. 29, so the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, went up to Ramoth Gilead for battle. No matter what the Lord said through Micaiah, they're going to continue. And this is probably, Jehoshaphat was a good king. He did a lot of positive things for Judah. And this is probably one of the most disappointing things I can think of in God's word concerning Jehoshaphat, that after Micaiah gave this prophecy, that he continued and went with Ahab. It almost cost him his life. Verse 30. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, I will disguise myself and enter into the battle. I'm going to dress up just like a common soldier. But put thou on thy robes. And the king of Israel disguised himself and went into the battle. He's putting a target on Jehoshaphat's back. What was the prophecy of the Lord? I saw the people of Israel scattered upon the hills or mountains, and they had no shepherd. They had no master. In other words, they had no king. And Ahab is saying, I'm going to put on my regular battle gear here and look like a normal soldier, but you put on your crown and your kingly robes, and then we'll go into battle. Verse 31, but the king of Syria, this is the same Ben-Hadad that was delivered into Ahab's hand not once, but twice, commanded his 32 captains, he got rid of the 32 drunks, the vassal kings, that had rule over his chariot, saying, fight neither with small nor great, save only with the king of Israel. I want his head. And here we have God in control. It wasn't the nation of Israel that he wanted to chastise. It was Ahab. This, I couldn't help but think back, 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 32, just 3 short years earlier, God had delivered Ben-Hadad into Ahab and Israel's hand. He feared for his life. You remember in the first time Ahab heard from Ben-Hadad, he said, your gold is mine, your silver is mine, your wives are mine, and your children are mine. And what did Ahab do after the second time that he defeated him? He was flattered that Ben-Hadad would send to him and ask for mercy. He invited Ben-Hadad up into his own chariot. Come on, old buddy, and called him my brother. Brother is right. Verse 32. And it came to pass when the captains of the chariot saw Jehoshaphat that they said, surely it is the king of Israel. And they turned aside to fight against him. And Jehoshaphat cried out, and in the Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 18, verse 31 and the following verses, it states that Jehoshaphat cried out to the Lord, and the Lord heard him and helped him. God moved them to depart from him. It was Ahab that God wanted chastised, not Jehoshaphat. But, you know, you can understand the Syrian soldiers. Ahab is disguised himself as a common soldier. And here he's got Jehoshaphat dressed up with his crown, his kingly robe. What else are the Syrians going to think? There's the king. 33. And it came to pass when the captains of the chariots perceived that it was not the king of Israel, that they turned back from pursuing him. They let Jehoshaphat go. It was Ahab that their boss, Ben-Hadad, wanted. That's who the Lord wanted as well, more importantly. Verse 34, and a certain man, this is a member of the Syrian armory, an archer, an army, an archer, drew a bow at a venture. This means in simplicity or just by chance. He fired an arrow and smote the king of Israel, Ahab, between the joints of the harness and the breastplate. Wherefore he said unto the driver of his chariot, turn thine hand, in other words, turn the reins of the chariot, and carry me out of the host, out of the army, for I am wounded. Was that just a lucky shot by chance? Or do you think God was directing that arrow? I think you know. Verse 35, and the battle increased that day, and the king, and this is Ahab, was stayed up in his chariot against the Syrians, and died at even, and the blood ran out of the wound into the midst of the chariot. Verse 36, and there went a proclamation throughout the host, the army, about the going down of the sun, saying, every man to his city, and every man to his own country. The prophecy of verse 17, the people of Israel scattered upon the hills with no shepherd, with no master, and they go home in peace. Did the prophecy of the 400 come to pass, or the prophecy of Micaiah? The prophecy of the Lord always comes to pass. Verse 37, so the king died and was brought to Samaria, and they buried the king in Samaria. And Jezebel will get hers as well. And one washed the chariot in the pool of Samaria, and the dogs licked up his blood, and they washed his armor according unto the word of the Lord which he spake. And prophecy of Elijah in chapter 21, verse 19, fulfilled here. Verse 39, now the rest of the acts of Ahab and all that he did, and the ivory house which he made, and all the cities that he built, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? And this ivory house, and make a note of Amos chapter 3, verse 15. And when God called judgment down on the nation of Israel, he said, I'm going to destroy your winter houses, I'm going to destroy your summer houses, and I'm going to destroy your ivory houses. Ivory houses, you see, are symbolic of houses built with ill-gotten gains. Verse 40, so Ahab slept with his fathers, and Ahaziah his son reigned in his stead. And you remember the prophecy, though, of Elijah in chapter 21, verse 26. All the males of the house of Ahab were going to be cut off. That means there wasn't going to be any posterity or children of Ahab survive. So Ahaziah becomes king, but not for long. Now we shift gears back, so we're going to go back in time a little bit. In this next verse, Jehoshaphat becomes king of Judah in the fourth year of Ahab. And we just covered the death of Ahab, so obviously the fourth year of Ahab was before that. So we'll go back a little bit in time. We're switching gears now back to Judah. And this becomes a little confusing here. And very shortly, we're going to have a king of Judah named Jehoram, and we're going to have a king of Israel named Jehoram at the same time. So we'll do our best to keep that sorted out. But let's go ahead with verse 41. And Jehoshaphat, if you translate it, means Yahweh judged. The son of Asa began to reign over Judah in the fourth year of Ahab, king of Israel. One of the few times where you had two righteous kings of Judah in a row. Asa was a very good king. Jehoshaphat, a very good king. Were they perfect? No, none of us are perfect. They fell short in certain areas, but they did a lot of good things as far as keeping the nation worshiping the Lord. Verse 42, Jehoshaphat was 35 years old when he began to reign, middle-aged, and he reigned 25 years in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Azubah, the daughter of Shilhi. And as we end verse 42, those of you with companion Bibles, note that that is the end of the 18th Seder. A Seder is a Hebrew term that meant that it was a prescribed section of reading per sitting. And when we started the Kings, I called to your attention that the original work of God, the First Kings and Second Kings, was one single book, not First Kings and Second Kings. That's by man's design and man's design only, and this proves it. Verse 43, we have the beginning of the 19th Seder, and it ends in 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 14. You didn't stop at the end of 1 Kings, in other words. And the history of Ahaziah and Elijah are split by this division, so it's not the end of 1 Kings to 2 Kings is what I'm talking about. And so it's a bad place to break. But as I mentioned when we began the Kings, this all came about when they were translating the Old Testament from the Hebrew language into the Greek language called the Septuagint. And what happened was the Greek language takes more space to write than on the Hebrew. And at that time, they wrote the Bible on scrolls made of leather or papyrus or a combination of the two. And they were translating the Hebrew to the Greek, and they ran out of scroll. And what did they do? Well, they said, well, there's 1 Kings, and this is going to be 2 Kings, as they grabbed another scroll. Well, we'll come back and cover the reign of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and get into the by man's design, 2 Kings, in our next lecture. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, Behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific denomination, organization, or individual by name. We try to teach God's Word in a positive format. Throwing about negative about others serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. We'll let God's Word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing. If you're studying via the internet somewhere around the world other than those places I just mentioned and unable to use the 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in being the point. Got a prayer request? We can do away with the telephone number. You don't need a mailing address. Talk to your Heavenly Father. I encourage you to do that. You know, I don't think you have a lot of competition these days. People are too busy for God. They forget about Him. They ignore Him. And you know, it makes His day when one of His children lets Him hear from them when there's something other than trouble. You know, how many times have you heard of a parent that has a child that moved away and the only time they hear from them is when they need something? I need to borrow $1,000, or I need to borrow this, or give me your old car or something. Always needing something, but don't let that be the only time that your Heavenly Father hears from you is in times of trouble. Tell Him that you love Him and thank Him for the blessings that He bestows upon you. And if you think that He's not blessing you, you're taking His blessings for granted. We do have these prayer requests, Father. We come united as one in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask You to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, problem marriages, financial difficulties, Father. You know, if it is Your will, a special blessing on each of these. We also lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank You, Father. All right, and if you're watching the live broadcast, we're going to break away for the Christmas holidays. You'll have a few specials next week and also some holiday specials, one of those being the Christmas special. I encourage you to be sure and catch that. If you've ever wondered about the actual conception date and actual birth date of Jesus Christ, be sure and catch it. But then as soon as those are run by, we'll be back and finish 1 Kings and get into 2 Kings. Questions. First up today, we got Susan in South Carolina. When babies die and go to heaven, do they stay babies or do they grow? I'd like to believe that they stay babies, so I could see my sister's baby. He died when he was only 3 days old. Okay, Susan. Well, you know, when the flesh dies, we step out into our spiritual bodies. And all spiritual bodies are the same age. Now, and when God made it to where man could see one of those spiritual bodies, an angel, for example, they were always young adults. And, you know, when you think about it, age is really irrelevant in a spiritual body. Unlike the flesh body, which is limited as far as the amount of time it's designed to absorb, the spiritual body is made to take on an eternity, and therefore age is really irrelevant. Gary in Michigan, my first question is, how many times can you repent for your sins? Is it 7 times 70 per day or 7 times 70 in a lifetime? And Gary's referring to Matthew chapter 18, verse 22 in the following verses, where some of the disciples asked Jesus, how oft should I forgive someone who trespasses against me? 7 times? And Jesus said, no, not 7 times, 7 times 70, which is 490. It doesn't say whether that's a lifetime or a day. I think it's a day. My second question is, will Father strengthen us before the 5-month period, or does He do it day by day? Thank you, and God bless Shepherd's Chapel. Thank you for the blessing and blessings back your way. You know, the two witnesses are going to be on earth just before the Antichrist returns, and they're going to be pumping oil, symbolic of truth. They're called the two olive trees of, what is it, Zechariah chapter 4 and Revelation chapter 11 also records about the two witnesses. But They're going to be feeding the 7,000 of God's elect. God never leaves anything to chance when it comes to accomplishing his plan and his will. You know, angels have always been sent to prepare people. You remember Gabriel appeared to Mary and told her, you see, that was something very unusual that was going to happen. She'd never been with a man, but she was going to conceive a child. And Gabriel came and prepared her for that. I think the two witnesses will be preparing God's elect for the actual event. Yes, we will be strengthened by the two witnesses. Jose in Arizona, will you please document when Jesus was born? Well, I just he was born September 29th. Why do we celebrate Christmas? Well, Jesus was conceived on Christmas Day, the 25th of December, and born on September 29th. And, you know, when he was conceived, the Word became flesh, and that is something to celebrate in my book. We'll be airing, as I mentioned earlier, the Christmas special over the next few days, so be sure and catch that, Jose. And through understanding the course of Abiah, you see there were 24 courses of the priest in the days. They're covered and established in the book of First Chronicles while David was king over all of Israel. And through understanding those 24 courses, specifically the eighth course, Abiah, which is mentioned in Luke chapter 1, we're able to determine the conception date and therefore the birth date of John the Baptist. John the Baptist was 6 months older than Christ, so therefore we're able to determine the conception date and the birth date of Jesus Christ. Dick in California, my question is really tied to the coming of Satan at the sixth trump. Matthew 24, verse 5 tells us that, and these are the words of Christ you mentioned, that many will come in my name saying that they are Christ. But when you seem to get to this, it is left out of the sermon or skipped over. My question is tied to this verse, and if indeed we are in last days, I can't recall anyone doing miracles and saying they are the Christ, let alone many people doing this or saying this. Is this a literal statement, or is not just how should we look? If not, how should we look at it? Well, there's nothing said there about miracles. It says there are many that say they are of Christ. And, you know, today we have many who are claiming to be Christians and they are deceiving God's children. They stand at the pulpits where the Word of God should be taught from, but they, you know, and anytime a pastor, you see them on Sunday, the super preachers, they get on there and they might read one verse of God's Word, and then they talk for 45 minutes or an hour. You see, someone who does that is not teaching God's Word. They think their words are more important than God's Word. They're false teachers, and that's what Christ was warning about in the events leading up to his return. There would be many claiming to be Christ, claiming to be Christ man, Christians, but they are false teachers. He was right. Iris in North Carolina. I heard Dennis announce that starting January 1, Dish Network will run the program 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. What about DirecTV? Will the programming also increase there? I have DirecTV and would love the increased availability of Shepherd's Chapel. God bless you all, and God bless you as well. We have no new programming scheduled for DirecTV at this time. And of course, there are two different contracts one with Dish Network, one with DirecTV, obviously. What happens on one doesn't affect the other in any way. So, of course, we're on DirecTV. For those of you who don't know, we're on DirecTV 19 hours a day, I think it is, Monday through Friday. So that's a considerable amount of hours on DirecTV. Francis from Tennessee, if the people were made on the sixth day, did they go to the land of Nod? If they did, how did they become born of woman? Please help me to understand this. Well, you're not understanding something, because in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, where God said, let us, speaking to the angels, make man in our image, he made male and female alike, it states there in verse 28 or 27 of Genesis chapter 1. Now, that was the sixth day creation, and you have the eighth day creation in Genesis chapter 2. Some of the sixth day creation obviously went to Nod, as we learn in Genesis chapter 4, verse 16, when Cain was booted out of the Garden of Eden, he went east to the land of Nod and took a wife there. So there were other people on earth than Adam and Eve and their children at that time, obviously. Dalton in Texas, what does 1 Chronicles 2:55 mean, please? Well, it means the families of the scribes are Kenites. What are Kenites? Kenites are the sons of Cain. And 1 Chronicles 2:55, the Kenites had become scribes of the tribe of Judah. And the significant point about that verse is that it proves that Kenites survived the flood of Noah's time, because 1 Chronicles 2:55 is centuries and centuries after the flood of Noah's time. And you follow with the second question, what does Ecclesiastes 12:7 mean? It means when we die, the flesh returns to the earth and our spirit returns to Father from whence it came. Ronnie in Alabama, if somebody wants to commit suicide and ask God for forgiveness beforehand, will God forgive them? Well, I don't know the answer to that, Ronnie. You know, that's up to God entirely. He is, and he alone is, the judge, and that's with a capital J. I do know this, that if you commit suicide, you have murdered one of God's children. And I believe that if someone commits suicide, the first thing that one sees after committing suicide is a very angry father. Rose in California, I have been divorced for 19 years. Is it okay for me to remarry? Well, if you've asked forgiveness, and that means that the sin was blotted out. It's like it didn't exist at all, and never to be thought about or brought up again. So to me, Jesus forgives. I know a lot of religions try to make second-class citizens out of divorcees, but you know, divorce is a terrible, terrible thing, and I certainly don't want to be perceived as that I support people who go through a divorce. It's an awful thing, especially when children are involved. It's terrible. And I got a letter the other day from a guy. This has nothing to do with you, Rose, but he had been through a divorce. And he said to me, he said, I thought she said she was going to take my stuff to the cleaners. But what she did was she took me to the cleaners and took my stuff. So, you know, it's a terrible tragedy, divorces, because lives are impacted, and it's up there as far as stress causers with the death of a loved one. So, but Rose, I would say that you're free to be happy, you know, remarry and be happy. Alicia in California, Jesus is the begotten Son of God. Does this mean that he was taken from someone else? Please explain. No, that's not what begotten means, Alicia. Begotten in the Greek language is monogenes, and it means simply the only born. And Jesus was the only born Son of God. He wasn't taken, he was given for the sins of the world. Betty in Missouri, is the paradise we go to when we die the same as the paradise after the great white throne judgment? No, paradise after the white throne judgment is the eternity. And that will be right here on earth. You see, the throne of God is coming here. We're not going anywhere if you're still in the flesh when Christ returns. We're not flying out of here, in other words. But the eternity, Revelation chapter 21, the first five verses state that the throne of God comes down from heaven and is here on earth. This is where the eternity will be. Leon in Alabama, tell me the importance of tithing and sowing righteousness like sowing a seed into a church ministry, and where may I find this in the Bible? Okay, on tithing first, Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, the prophecy of God by the prophet Malachi, bring the tithes into the storehouses that there may be meat in my house. Not milk, but meat of God's word being taught in my house. That's the church. I will open, this is the Lord speaking, the windows of heaven to bless your socks off. Well, I'm paraphrasing kinda, but that's what the importance of tithing is to keep the word of God being taught in the churches. And that's where you should tithe, where you are taught. You know, we don't spend a lot of time on that subject here at the chapel. Why? Because we believe that teaching God's word is more important. And people, when they're taught the word, they appreciate it, and they're smart enough to know that if you're going to keep it coming, you have to support it. And we have no problems. We don't have telethons to raise funds. You never hear us say, well, if you don't hurry up and send in $100, we're probably not going to be on this station next month. You don't ever hear us say that. We're not beggars. As far as planting a seed and sowing righteousness, I would refer you to Luke chapter 8 or Matthew chapter 13, where you have the parable of the sower. And who do we have? Fran in Pennsylvania. Where are the Kenites now? Do they want to destroy America and Christians? How do we recognize them? And are we getting really close to the coming of Antichrist? The labor pangs are becoming increasingly closer and closer. Watch, watchmen, watch. Kenites have mixed with all peoples on earth. How do we recognize them? Well, Jesus taught us in Matthew chapter 7, verse 16, where Jesus states, by their fruits you will know them. You don't judge people by what they say, you judge them by their action, their fruits. Marlon in Minnesota, did the people of the first earth age hunt, grow food, and did they have flight? Did they fly? Well, there wasn't any need to hunt for food, because in a spiritual body, you wouldn't eat flesh. There were animals in the flesh in the first earth age, but no man in the flesh. Were they able to fly? I think probably so, a whole lot better than what we're able to fly today. Larry in Florida, when did the first earth age begin, and as far as a year and timeline? You know, God is eternal. The eternity means without beginning and without end. And if you mean what year were all souls created in the first earth age, that isn't written in the Bible. Ira in North Carolina, is one time enough to anoint your home, and then you should have faith that the Lord will help? Is it okay to anoint again if needed? There's nothing wrong with anointing your home more than once. When people come to your home, it's possible for negative, evil spirits to piggyback into your home. So next time you're anointing your home, you might include not only ordering what's in the home, negative and evil, out in the name of Jesus Christ, order it off of the back of anyone visiting this home. Carrie in Kentucky, where is it in the Bible about the key of David? Revelation chapter 3, verse 7 and the following verses, that key that if you have it, it shuts doors that no man can open and opens doors that no man can shut. Lonnie in California, Wednesday morning you were talking about Adam and Eve. You said Eve came from Adam's rib. Arnold said hex curve. That's a big difference for a young listener. Well, you weren't listening that day because I said the word rib means curve, and that likely was the helix curve of Adam's DNA that Eve was taken. I'm out of time. I want to wish you and your families a very Merry Christmas if you're watching the live program as we enter the holiday season. Remember the reason for the season and don't get all stressed out with the commercialism and all that goes into the holidays. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. One thing most important, though, beloved, and it's this, stay in His Word every day. You know, every day in your Father's Word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus, Yeshua, is the living Word.
Hearing God's Word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Peter. Here we have two books, 1st and 2nd Peter, that are absolutely fascinating. That great old fisherman telling us, leading us, directing us, guiding us, going into the depth, if you would, in that second book, into the three earth ages, giving the most accurate recorded account of the events that transpire and document that there are three earth ages, that there was one before this one, and one to come. Peter, the great fisherman, which in his gentleness and his kindness brings us two books, the books of Peter, that lead, guide, direct, even in your daily life, that teach and show you how to be happy, how to find that peace of mind, and to know yourself. The books of Peter, I know you're going to enjoy them.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Say, welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. The Ark of the Last Days. What an interesting subject. You know, there will be an ark in the end times. As there was in Noah's day, there was an ark. Will the earth be flooded again with water? No, not at all.